Rugged, high mountain peaks have blocked the way of people traveling over the Silk Road. Pamir, the roof of the world. Crowded here are towering mountain ranges like the Tian Shan, Kunlun, Hindu Kush, and Karakoram ranges, which form a gigantic wall through the middle of the Asian continent. The roof of the world spreads over the borders of various countries of China, India, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. We, the Silk Road coverage team, left Xi'an, ancient capital of China, and after having traveled westward for a year and a half, found ourselves on the western edge of China. We are standing on the Hunza Pass, the ridge that divides the world into east and west. The elevation here is 4,943 meters. A single road runs through the pass. It is the Karakoram Highway, which links China with Pakistan. The national border signpost erected on the ridge. We have been allowed to stand here by special permission of the Pakistani and the Chinese governments. Every year, in spring and autumn, trucks travel back and forth between Kashgar in China and Gilgit in Pakistan. These people are returning to Pakistan with their trucks laden with Chinese goods. Chinese people seeing the Pakistanis off. People engaged in frontier trade part company at this pass after final handshakes. Thank you for all your troubles. We will be sure to visit Gilgit in autumn.
Thank you very much.
They must leave the ridge behind before the snowfall becomes severe. They must travel over the mountain road for more than 200 kilometers to reach Gilgit. An amicable relationship is the primary reason for interchange between Gilgit and Kashgar. Neither side spends foreign currency. Barter is the means of trade. We were told that sundry items of everyday use, such as ceramic ware, tea and thermal bottles, and an abundance of silk fabrics are brought from Kashgar. Trucks in Gilgit are delightful just to look at. They are decorated with colourful pictures and patterns. The road in early spring, when the snow begins to melt, is full of danger. Travelers meet avalanches and landslides here and there. Ali Khadra, the driver, had his first opportunity to travel to Kashgar. He had been looking forward to this chance. The running condition of the truck has been my greatest worry, as the air is thin around the ridge, he said while looking straight ahead as he was driving over an unfamiliar road. Some 100 kilometers from the ridge, the ravine became somewhat wider. The 10 trucks picked up speed and raced on towards Gilgit. The Karakoram Highway we are following was built by cutting open the mountain ranges. The elevation around here is 3,500 meters. We came upon a villager herding a flock of yak near the glacier, though the place was a world sealed by rocks and glaciers. The yaks are the only means of transporting cargo at such high altitudes. The Chinese history book describes the road that runs along this place towards Gandhara as the oldest of the ancient trade routes. Silk was transported over this road. Buddhism from India was brought into China over this road. This is the Silk Road, featuring snow, ice, and rocks. We, the coverage team, are headed for Gandhara, over the very same road. We have descended to an altitude of 2,500 meters and begin to notice that it is becoming warmer. On taking a long curve towards the right, we come upon a wider valley. Here lies the village of Hunza. It is now April, mid-spring, and the whole village of Hunza was literally buried under white blossoms. They were apricot blossoms. The scene was indeed worthy of being described as the Shangri-La of the Karakoram Mountains. Very little level land is available in Hunza. These small terrace fields are propped up with carefully erected stone walls. Wheat, potatoes and onions are planted mainly on the little field area available. The apricot season is a time when even old people and children are mobilized to do farm work. Grey, turbid water from melting snow is the water supply that sustains life in Hunza. The conduits, built by the villagers in full force, guide the water from the mountains to the fields, and from the fields into the houses. What the women are concerned with most are apricot blossoms, since apricots which ripen in autumn are made into preserved food which is indispensable in winter. A building that served at one time as the castle for the Mir of Hunza remains on the low hill in the village. It is known as the Baltit Castle. Hunza has a long history. The king and his clan, who used to live in the castle, are said to have come from Iran 900 years ago. The people carried on brisk interchange with China, and as many travelers stopped over in this area, the kingdom prospered for a long time. We encountered a wedding procession. People were taking the bride to the home of the bridegroom. Not show us her face. We were told that it was the custom to keep the veil on till the wedding ceremony is over. People's rejoicing adds gaiety to spring in Hunza. With blossoms and snowy mountains, the people of Hunza have led quiet and peaceful lives for centuries in this village facing the Silk Road.
Valley in Hunza.
Hunza is a village well known throughout the world for its people's long lifespan.
It has always been the seat of the Mir of Hunza, of this area. Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam.
Aye.
Aye.
Chalo. Chalo beta, shabash. The place, as you know, looks a little dirty, but that's how life is here.
Yeah. Assalamu alaikum.
Please come.
Yep.
I want you to meet Mr. Ali Murad that you have come to meet from so far.
We visited the oldest man in the village who lived near the Baltit Castle.
Hirose sahab hain. Hirose sahab Japan se aaye hain.
Aur ye Mubarak ho aapko.
Team ke leader hain.
The old man, named Ali Murad, was sitting leisurely with his great-grandchild in his lap.
चाय पी के आपको तशरीफ लाओ
आप आइए.
The old man received us cheerfully in spite of our unannounced visit. He called another family living nearby and served us tea. The tea contained large amounts of milk and sugar. When we wanted to know his age, he said he should be 108 years old. His hearing and sight were still good. He told us in the local dialect, known as Rushuski, about his younger days.
तो था खानी
उल तन्नीस इत सफर बुट.
Do you remember going to China?
सफर बिलुम अखी बिलुम असे भाई
तगलीब सफर मिशास के गन.
It must have been some 70 years ago. We took some tributes.
लुबगो सर बस सर मैदान.
I went together with many friends, but the journey was hard. Tashkogan was the first place we visited. The backyard was readied for dancing before we realized what was going on. The old man said he would perform dances for the coverage team from a far-off land. We were worried somewhat, wondering if an old man of 108 years could really dance. But without concerning himself with such thoughts, the old man began to move about in time with the flute and the drums. The old man's remembrances of his journey through life seemed to have been touched by this dance, which he said he learned at the castle in his younger days. How delightful it was when we danced at Kashgar. In Khotan, we used to dance till late at night. the Silk Road coverage team left Hunza behind and continued with the downhill travel along the Karakoram Highway. The road is cut along the precipitous mountainside several hundred meters above the Hunza River. A narrow, ribbon-like road which cut along the precipice on the opposite bank of the river was also visible. This is the old road that was used before the Karakoram Highway was built. Even today, this road links the villages along the river. It is a road indispensable to the people of the villages for transporting goods that sustain their lives. We are told that the travel across Pamir used to take a whole month. The travellers must have advanced gingerly over the narrow road running along sheer precipices. A Chinese history book says, an accidental fall from the rugged road will mean both man and his horse will be torn to pieces before they reach the bottom of the ravine. We happen to witness a landslide sweeping across this road. Many people from the villages must have travelled over this road that has existed through such a long period of history. And this very road disappeared directly before our eyes. We crossed the bridge over the ravine as gingerly as we could. Gilgit lay just beyond the suspension bridge. Shortly after crossing the suspension bridge, we came upon the first trace of Buddhism. A huge Buddha image was carved on the rocky wall. It must have measured 5 meters tall and appeared to be a work from the 5th or 6th century. Buddhism flourished in this region around that time. Today, voices reciting the Quran are heard in Gilgit. No trace of the Buddhism that flourished so brilliantly so as to make a Chinese monk named Zhuang Zhang write about several hundred temples and several thousand monks is now to be seen. In the street are seen many men, clearly different in features from the local people. Being a town located near the borders of China, India and Afghanistan, people of different races come and go in large numbers. We visited the home of Ali Khadra in the suburb of Gilgit. He is the truck driver we met at the Khunjirab Pass.
This is his truck.
Yes, this is his truck.
Oh, good truck.
Yes. Mr. Ali Hadas.
Oh, hello. Hello. Good morning.
He did not smile when he was holding the steering wheel, probably because of tension, but we found him completely relaxed and at ease.
Yes. This is your house?
Yes.
Yes, come on. Thank you.
We were led into the sitting room, but Mrs. Khadra did not show herself, as is the custom of the region. We were treated to a cup of tea using the new cups said to have been bought from Kashgar. People of Gilgit drink green tea quite often, probably because of the influence of the Chinese with whom they trade. The Chinese are our great friends. In particular, people of Gilgit and Kashgar associate with one another like members of a single family. Going over the ridge is hard work, but I would like to go there once again. The road that leaves Gilgit behind comes upon a river. It is the River Indus. From here, the Karakoram Highway runs along the River Indus. A man was waiting for the gondola coming across from the other side of the river. He has been waiting for 2 long hours, but it looked as though that was a matter of course. We waited together with the man, and after some time, the gondola made its appearance. The gondola lightly slid down at first, but it had to be hauled up by hand in the end. The driver told us that the goat ferried across at the request of a villager was the 3rd passenger of the day. Chilas is a town about 100 kilometers away from Gilgit. Large numbers of Buddha images in all sorts of poses are found engraved on the rocks around this town. Professor Dani, a Pakistani archaeologist who has studied these pictures, says they may have been drawn around the 5th century. The name of Chilas frequently appears in Chinese history books. The reason is that people visiting Gandhara always pass through this town. The pictures may have been the work of monks and other travelers who engraved them in token prayers for safe travel and spiritual tranquility. A small check station was set up not far from Chilas. Three police officers were stationed there to check the travellers, especially foreign travellers. Such checks were being made only in this region, known as the frontier provinces. It was a glimpse of the strict security measures taken in the border area. Fortunately, we were allowed to go through merely by writing down our passport numbers and our names. The weather over the mountains suddenly changes. A sudden gust of wind blew through the Indus Ravine. Rain invariably comes after a windstorm. The condition of the road changes suddenly. We were told that the Karakoram highway construction proved exceedingly difficult, and more than 3,000 lives were sacrificed before it was completed. The whole length of the road opened for service 4 years ago. Even now, the cliffs above the road are unstable, and falling rocks are routine occurrences. Unfortunately, it is the season when snow and ice begin to melt, and snow water floods across the road. Karakoram Highway terminates at Talkoot, where the Indus River becomes much wider. The road extends for 645 kilometers from the Hunza Pass. And across the Indus River lies the province of Gandhara, the destination of our journey at this time. Gandhara is a special place. Buddha images created in this place were brought into Japan and exerted widespread influence on the Buddhist culture of Japan. This mountain temple, Taktibahi, is said to have been built in the 2nd century. Rockworks and foundation stones still remaining here are indications of numerous temples and stupas that must have stood there in those days. Several hundred Buddhist monks must have led a life of daily prayer in this place, and Chinese monks in quest of true teaching may have stopped here as well. Not only the Buddhist monks, but also lay people of Gandhara must have visited the temple and, with their palms held together, prayed to the Buddha for spiritual tranquility. Gandhara is the junction where the roads extending from China in the east, from India in the south, and from Iran in the west come together. Buddhism was propagated early in this region and took root. The endless flow of the Indus River. Mild climate and abundant verdure. People prayed and Gandhara prospered for a long time, together with Buddhism. People of Gandhara today are fervent Muslims. Buddhism is nothing more than something that existed in days long past. It is written that when a Chinese monk, Xuanzang, visited this place in the 7th century, Buddhism was already beginning to show signs of decline. Gandhara reached its peak of prosperity during the 2nd century under King Kanishka, who established the Kushana dynasty. The brilliant history written during this period is hidden in the ruins and Buddhist images scattered throughout the district. King of Kings, Kanishka of Kushan. This is what King Kanishka called himself while he was the master of this vast territory. The capital city of the kingdom was named Purusapura, meaning the city of flowers. Many legends connected with King Kanishka are related in Gandhara. One day, King Kanishka met a herd boy. The herd boy spoke of the ancient prophecy of the Buddha to the king, The prophecy was about the appearance of a king named Kanishka, who would build Buddhist stupas. Mindful of the herd boy's words, the king promptly had a stone stupa built. The legend says that this stupa began to grow by itself, larger and larger, and finally became 400 feet high and a mile and a half around. This is the story of the great stupa of King Kanishka, as told in Siyuki, the travelogue of Zhuang Zhang. We wonder if the story of the great stupa of King Kanishka is a mere legend. Early this century, a British archaeologist named Spooner accidentally came upon the answer to the mystery. He undertook excavation of an old Buddhist stupa near the ancient city of flowers, Purusapura, or the present-day city of Peshawar. He discovered a bronze casket in the center section of the stupa. The casket measured 13 centimeters in diameter and 20 centimeters in height. Among the delicate engravings on the casket, a portrait of King Kanishka was found. The words, written in ancient Kharosthi, clearly included the name King Kanishka. The legend of King Kanishka, the protector of Buddhism, was thus demonstrated. Buddhism that originated in India was brought to Gandhara. Greeks from far to the west were also discovered living here. Buddhists of those days were still incapable of carving Buddha images. They were unable to conceive of the idea of concretely expressing the image of Buddha. The Greeks, however, already had ample experience in creating images of their gods and goddesses. The meeting of the bold thinking of the Western people and the Buddha nature of the Eastern people gave rise to Buddha images. Buddha images that still preserve traces of Greek-style sculpture may have strongly appealed to the people. People of Gandhara have carved many types of Buddha images. The fasting Siddhartha is considered to be the greatest masterpiece among the numerous Buddhist images found in Gandhara. Emaciated muscles. Blood vessels standing out. Deep love for the Buddha, held by the people of Gandhara, is embodied in the figure of Siddhartha in ascetic practice. Given a new phase of Buddhism in the form of Buddhist images, the religion spread with renewed vigor. Buddhism moved eastwards from Gandhara, crossing Pamir, striding over the Taklamakan Desert and reaching Chang'an. From there, it crossed the sea into Japan.